When it comes to money stories, I gotta say that my fellow therapists and I have to be some of the worst when it comes to hearing and repeating negative money stories. In grad school, as I was getting my master's in social work, I heard professors say everything from, "You didn't go into this field because you care about money," to, "Social workers who go into private practice aren't really social workers." Mm-hmm. And I'm sure for my fellow helpers and healers out there listening, a lot of those types of sentiments really resonate. We've heard them again and again and again, this idea that you can't help others and earn a good living. So to that end, I am thrilled today to bring on three guests, three different therapists who have worked through various money stories, and their stories are so helpful at just hearing where we come from and what we had to overcome in order to create sustainable private practices. So this episode is great for you if you are a therapist in private practice, obviously, but it's really helpful for anybody who has internalized these ideas that having money and being a good person are somehow mutually exclusive. I cannot wait for you to listen in to my conversation with Courtland, John, and Alli. Stay tuned until the end because I'm sharing a little something new I'm excited to get your feedback on. Welcome to Mind Money Balance. I'm Lindsay, a popcorn lover, woman of color, and financial therapist and coach. This is the No Guilt, No Shame podcast to help you stand in your financial power. Let's go.
Courtland, why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself? Tell us a little bit about who you are, where you practice, and what's your niche?
So Lindsay, it's great to be on your podcast. So thank you for allowing me this opportunity. My name is Courtland McPherson. I'm a licensed clinical social worker. I'm actually in Alameda, California, which is a little island outside of Oakland, California, across from the Bay of, across from San Francisco, excuse me. And I have a private practice here. And that private practice materialized about, well, almost 5 years ago now when I was moved out to California with my wife. She said, "Hey, I'm leaving Boston. Do you want to come with me?" And when I came out here, I decided that there was a need for working with men specifically. And so most of the people I work with identify as men, and they, you know, come in for various reasons, relationship issues, work issues, life issues, transition issues, those kind of things. And my real goal is to help men be better men.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Courtland. John.
Well, hi, Lindsay. It's good to speak with you. My name is John Sovec, and I'm a therapist out here in Pasadena, California. I actually specialize in working with adolescents, and my primary real deep specialty is working with LGBTQ adolescents and their families during the coming out process. I actually travel around the country, well, sometimes, and teach at conferences, do trainings for lots of schools and for recovery centers. And then currently doing a lot of webinars and writing on this subject. You know, it's a really powerful thing that a lot of kids are going through. And as an openly queer therapist myself, I think having a therapist when I was younger who was trained in how to help me through this process would have been amazing. So that's kind of how I ended up there.
Love it. And Alli.
Hi, Lindsay. Thanks so much for the opportunity. I was excited to be a female representing on this podcast today. My name is Alli Douglas Guerrero, and I live in Colorado. I have a private practice in Broomfield, Colorado, just near Boulder. And my practice is called Whole Health Counseling, and we have just expanded to be a group now. So there are going to be three of us. My niche, I discovered through my own personal life experience. So I specialize in working with high achieving, highly intelligent individuals struggling with stress management, anxiety, burnout, and toxic relationships.
Awesome. Well, I'm so glad you guys are all here. Thank you so much for taking the time. I'm so envious of everybody's locations. For my podcast listeners who are new, I'm here in the Midwest. I'm in Ann Arbor, so I don't have all the luxuries of being where our guests are today. So the hope today is to just share with our fellow therapist listeners that it is possible, in fact, to be a therapist, to make good money, and to be a good person. So I want to dive into money stories and niching and barriers with fees and really help to just normalize that these are normal barriers that a lot of us therapists run into, and also to highlight that there's more than one way to make it to a profitable practice. I love how each of you guys has your own unique niche and the power of being able to say, this is who I serve, this is who I'm really uniquely qualified to help, and really stepping into that power. So for the second question, I'll start with John, then go to Alli, and end with Courtland. So question number two, what unhelpful money stories did you have to overcome, John, to create a profitable private practice? Like, what were some things maybe holding you back from raising your rates, and how did you get through that?
Well, you know, it's really interesting because when I was thinking of having this conversation with you, I actually looked even farther back to the money stories that I had been raised with. My mom was a Depression era baby, and she had grown up during this period when there was nothing. They were living in the basement of a relative's house, barely scraping by. And that experience colored her entire life and her relationship to money. Even when I was growing up and we were in a very well-to-do family in a great neighborhood, going to good schools, she always walked through life as if it was all going to fall apart immediately. And that's what I grew up with. And it was really fascinating because I would suggest that probably for the first 20, 25 years of my life, I ascribed to that. I was really careful with money. Anytime I earned something, it immediately went into the savings that I didn't spend it on myself or spend it on improvement. And I really did it. And I thought I was doing the right thing. And then one day I was talking to a friend of mine and they talked about, like, well, being generous with myself. And I was like, I don't even know what that means. So I took that phrase into my therapist and we started talking about my relationship with finances and what my mom had taught me and how maybe it was something to learn how to balance with. So rather than just thinking money is meant to be saved and squirreled away, is that money is this living, breathing thing that we can do amazing stuff with. And I know for myself, that really helped me when I started growing into this practice. When I look at money in my practice, I look at money as a way that we've chosen to exchange energy in the room. I've gone to school, I've learned these amazing techniques and abilities and skills, and I'm going to be present with you in that room and help you walk through the challenges you're facing. And the way you're going to recognize that energy that I give you is by exchanging a monetary form with me. And by shifting to that energy, especially in my practice, it changes the whole dynamic in the room. I absolutely believe 100% in abundance. I'm one of those people who refers out a lot in my practice. If you're not a right fit for me, I refer you out. And one of the reasons is because I believe there are more than enough clients and more than enough opportunities for all of us. And so this really deep abundance mindset has shifted my life dramatically and made opening my practice pretty powerful really quickly right off the bat.
Oh my gosh. Well, thank you for taking us back in time. Research shows that most of us have an idea about what money is and assign meaning to money when we're children. So it makes perfect sense that as you reflected on this question, plus the fact that you're a therapist, you went way back. And I love that you were able to really show us the different pathway that you took and how you got there. And I love how you said that money is an energy exchange and that's what feels really good for you, and not feeling frantic or scared if you have to turn away a client because it's not a good fit. Wonderful. And Alli, what about you? What unhelpful money stories did you have to overcome?
Several. It was interesting what John was saying just about your family, right? And how our parents and their experiences obviously shape our stories about money. I had the unique experience of being raised in a family where my father's an entrepreneur. He owns all his own businesses and he's always had that hustle mindset, I would say. So on the one hand, I felt like that made it a bit easier for me because I think I always saw it modeled to me that I had the opportunity to achieve great things, make money by being creative and take my own path versus going down the main road. So that definitely made it probably easier for me than some people in that regard. But I also watched my father and my mother work constantly. They would stay up till 2 a.m. most nights. For 20 or 30 years, my dad probably slept 4 hours a night in order to achieve that. So one of the biggest money stories that I've been working through since starting a private practice is the idea that I have to work incessantly, nonstop, and be constantly in this go, go, go masculine energy in order to make money. That's a big one that I would say I even still sometimes am working on being more balanced. But one of the other ones I had in the past after graduation was definitely the fact that it was very binary in my thinking, right? If you're a social worker or a therapist, then you must be a good person who's more about helping people than trying to make a dollar off someone. I just felt like at the time when I was younger, I truly felt like that was ick. Like I just couldn't do that and maintain my identity as a helper. And when I worked my first jobs, my master's degree is actually in clinical psychology. So I didn't get as much of that in my program because I originally wasn't even planning to be a counselor. I thought I would go through my doctorate in research. But I got burned out of school and started working right away with women and children who had chronic homelessness situations. And I think, you know, having 3 years of my first experience outside of grad school working with that population, I just thought these are the people who need the help the most and they tend to get the people who are the greenest. And how can I be a kind, good therapist if I charge these high rates, right? Because those people aren't going to get help from me if my rate's too high. I've watched a lot of podcasts and done a lot of work around this. And one of the biggest messages that helped me was to understand that if I raise my rate, I can give back in other ways outside of one-on-one individual therapy. I will be moving this year into also doing online group coaching where I can extend my touch. And if you want to scale a business and you really want to make an impact in the world, you know, the one-on-one model is limiting. It's not bad by any means, but it does, you know, you have 40 hours a week and hopefully you're not working with 8 clients a day, every day. And that's where it caps, right? So one of the things I understood was being more flexible in my thinking about what rate I set allows me the opportunity to do other things that might touch more people and give back in different ways, as well as the clients that I worked with that were struggling needed systemic change more than they needed an individual therapist only. I still think the work I did was valuable, but I think being able to get back to charity or have free time to volunteer and make differences in legislation, right, in the organizations that help the systemic change are all things that you can have energy to do if you have a higher rate. If your rate is low, you're not going to have a lot of free time to do any of those things because you're usually going to be on a fast track to burnout. So I think the two main stories that I would say are the fact that I can give back to the world, be a true helper and maintain that piece of my identity, and also value myself and what I'm worth and the hard work it took to get here. And also the story that you don't have to work 12 hours a day to have a good living. And I think that goes back to John's abundance mindset, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it's interesting that that dynamic of in order to make money, I have to work really hard competing with I can't be a helper and make good money. So I'm glad that you were able to find a balance. And it sounds like it's something that's kind of on your mind always as you do this work. And Courtland, what about you? Share with us some of the unhelpful money stories that you had to overcome and to get into a sustainable pricing model with your work.
Sure. So I love what everybody's saying about their histories with their families, right? You know, we all, I think, have some family dynamics that play into how we think about money. And for me, you know, I grew up in severe poverty. And the interesting part about that was I was the poor kid in a very rich community. You know, it was hand-me-down clothes. We were on food stamps. You know, we weren't sure a lot of times where our next meal was going to come from. I joke with people sometimes, I hate saltine crackers to this day because they were, sometimes that was dinner. And, you know, my parents, you know, I think did their best, you know, very blue collar family that we had, but we didn't have electricity a lot of times. You know, we were always running out of oil. And I grew up in Rhode Island on the East Coast. And let me tell you, when winter hits and there's no electricity and oil, and you're sleeping in a sleeping bag in your living room, you know, just trying to stay warm, and you're bundled up in 14 layers of clothes, you know, those things stick around with you. You know, and I started my first job when I was about 10 years old. I was delivering newspapers on a bike, you know, the classic paperboy type of thing. But that money wasn't for me. That money was going to maybe buy some groceries. That money was, you know, maybe trying to pay that electric bill. I remember, I think it was 1991 or two or something like that. My mom made $12,000 that year. That is not enough for a family of three. I have a sister to subsist on. She was a single mom and did her, you know, she struggled a lot. And money for my family was always more of about survival. It was like, if you had it, you had to try to figure out how to, you know, whether it's the electric bill, the water bill, the heat, food, what were the trade-offs with those things? That story stuck with me probably throughout most of my life, probably until I would say the last 5 to 10 years even. And when I went to grad school and became a social worker, you know, social workers inherently are told, you know, like, we should just help people. You have to get out of this, your schooling, and then enter into a community mental health agency, and you are fee for service, and you work 8 hours. You know, I like what Alli was saying, you know, you're working 8 hours a day expecting for clients to show up, and they don't, but you're actually not getting paid for that 8 hours of time, right? You're sort of sitting there and you have two clients and you make $40 for 8 hours of the day. And that's just not sustainable. Right. So as I journeyed backwards and thinking about my own money story and the history there, I had to switch that mindset to say, like, I'm worth more than this. And my time is worth more than this. But that went even deeper, right? That story was, I'm worth more than this. I'm good enough. And in my family, I was never good enough, right? You know, the money was sort of always the catalyst. It was like, how do we survive in this? And then family dynamics, us kids sort of took a little bit of a backseat to what my parents were trying to do, which no fault of theirs. I think, you know, life happens to people. So when I decided to open my own private practice, some of those stories actually stuck around. Well, to build a successful practice, you got to get clients through the door. So lower your rates and start out really low and get people in, see as many people as possible. And I realized, long, you know, in the first year of my private practice, that was not sustainable. I mean, I was burning out. And I said to my partner, my wife, I can't keep doing this. And she said, well, don't, you know, and she was one of the first.
She made people. It sound easy.
She did make it sound easy, but she was one of the first people who also helped me sort of see, like, you don't have to keep doing this the way you're doing it. She made it okay. And she made it okay for me to believe it was okay, right? Because I don't think we all go through this stuff alone, right? We do this sometimes with support of our friends, our family, the people around us. And, you know, when I started to really think about it, I was like, well, wait a second. How can I rework these numbers? How can I actually help men? You know, this goes back to what Allie's saying, right? If I have X amount of time in the day, if I'm only making $60 a session and I'm seeing 8 to 10 people, that's not sustainable. That's going to, again, lead to burnout. So I was able to up my rates to see less people, which means I'm actually sitting in the room and being a lot more present with those people to give back to those people while not worrying about, well, how am I going to keep my own electricity on? Because that's always in the background for me. And now, you know, a couple of years later, I don't have to worry so much about how to keep the electricity on. Still have some food insecurities, but that's a whole nother thing. But, you know, we get to sort of think about the story that's there and rework it. And even this past year, I raised my rates again because I believe that there's a value in doing that. I can see less people, right? That's what we're talking about. Make more money, think about life in a different way, you know, and I get to do that instead of working 5 days a week. I'm in my office three, right? Where I do my admin days on two other days, you know, so that I can focus on other work, right? For that scaling up model that, again, Alli was talking about.
Wonderful. Thank you. And thank you for just kind of showing a different picture and how that can show up. And I heard a little bit of this twinge of guilt of, like, I couldn't possibly charge money when I know what it's like to struggle financially. So to have to work through that story as well. And along with fees and charging more. The other kind of scarcity abundance dance that I see a lot of therapists get into is over the dreaded niche, right? Picking out who you're going to work with and why. Because again, a lot of us absorb these stories that we have to help everyone. And so then our websites look like every other therapist website. We went to this school, we have these credentials, we help adolescents, families, couples, individuals with worry, sleeplessness, anxiety, overwhelm, blah, 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 right? And it doesn't actually help when you're seeing clients who aren't a good fit for you, and or you're seeing clients who you might not really light up when you see. I know for me, when I first opened my private practice, I had an idea of like anxiety and depression clients, thinking that was a niche, but I really quickly learned that's actually like not the most narrow of niches, and I could get a broad range of people that I really wasn't the best fit for. So as I stayed in practice, it was almost, you know, this organic ever niching model that I would have happen of just kind of constantly reassessing and reevaluating who are the clients who are getting the best results, who are the clients that I feel excited to see and I don't feel drained by, who am I really helping the most. So I would love to hear from you guys on niching. For this round, we'll go Alli, Courtland, then John. So next question, how did you niche down? How did you land on your current niche? And did you have any worries about making the niche a little bit smaller?
Well, the third one, yes, absolutely. I had worked in community mental health type settings for all of my career for about 6 years before I moved into private practice. So that mindset was pretty strongly instilled in me, which was that at the time, I was a bilingual therapist working in a community mental health center, and I would see whoever I was assigned. And oftentimes, situations where you really felt like your skills were being stretched outside of your skill set at times, and you were still supposed to say yes and see individuals. So when I started my private practice, I started on insurance panels. I accepted private pay as well, but I did also have insurance clients, and they were the majority of my referrals at the beginning of my practice. So I had that same mentality at the time that someone's calling me, they've tried all these other people, they just can't find anybody else. If I'm on that panel, I still had this mindset that if I was on the panel, I was almost required to take them. And I really struggled with, I paid a lot of money for a business coach to help me specifically, a couple grand, I think, or something like that, just for niching and nothing else but that. And she was helpful, but I think I didn't get as much of a benefit out of it at the time as I could have, because I was still so entrenched in that mindset of like, I have an insurance practice. I have to help people and I have to take everybody. How do I do this niche if like I'm really passionate about toxic relationships and about helping high achievers find balance in their life, but I'm getting all these people calling that have bipolar, trauma, all these different things. And I'm a trauma therapist with extensive experience in some education specific in trauma. So I felt like I had to take them. So she helped me in imagining my ideal client. And also I would say, to your point, some hard lessons about what it feels like to be in session with someone who's not your ideal client and how that can affect your energy, your well-being, and not burning out was also a piece of what was really helpful to me in recognizing the importance of niching down. So I got my niche by working with that coach and imagining my ideal client, and also, of course, some of my own life experience. I think for many of us, we're passionate about something. Your niche has to be something that you're excited about, you're passionate about. And many times we care about it because of what we've been through. And I think coming from a very high achieving, masculine, strong, go, go, go energy family, it was something I worked through in my own personal healing to find balance with that. So that was a part of what shaped my passion for helping others in that particular niche. So I think my passion and noticing which clients got me the most excited. I actually looked at my calendar and read all the names and noticed what I felt in my body when I looked at each name. Started to notice a pattern that the people with some pretty high intense energy, sometimes struggling with toxic relationship problems, but like also anxiety and trying to do a lot at work, those kept being the ones that I really noticed I enjoyed. So that was a very helpful reflection exercise for me.
Awesome. Thank you. And Courtland, how did you get to your niche and what kind of mindset stuff did you have to overcome?
So I help men in their 20s, 30s, and 40s. That doesn't mean I don't help other men, depending on their age. But one of the things that led me to working with men was we're half the population, maybe a little less, I think, now. But men die sooner than women. We tend to have more health issues. These things are changing, by the way. Women are sort of catching up with some of this stuff, which is not a good thing. We tend to perpetuate more violence. We have this whole structure around us that is not healthy. And when I thought about my own work and the work that I was doing in a community mental health clinic, one of the things that started before I got into private practice was every single time a guy came into the clinic, they were sort of automatically assigned to me. Or when a five-year-old boy came into a clinic, he was assigned to me because I was the only male clinician. And whether good or bad, I don't know. What I know is that these men all wanted to do one thing, which was talk about stuff. And when I decided to open my practice, I was like, men want to talk about stuff. We have a systemic issue in the world, I believe, where we teach men bad behaviors. We teach them how to hold everything in, which is toxic. It's not good for us, right? And then what that does is that translates into issues for the people around us. You know, we again perpetuate violence. We, you know, perpetuate sexual abuse. We do all of these sort of horrible things. And a lot of that, I think, stems from the fact that we don't talk about what we have going on. Again, we're taught not to do that. So when I decided to niche down, I had all this anxiety because my practice is inclusive. You know, I will see anybody that sort of fits whatever, you know, comes my way in terms of, well, does it feel right? Can I help this person, right? If they have relationship issues, fine. If it's a person who identifies as a woman, fine. We can work that stuff out. But for men in particular, we don't, again, seek help. So I wanted to put that out there for men that we can talk about this stuff. Now, my dad was a cop, and he did not talk about a lot of things. You know, he had a very sort of stoic personality. One of the things that I learned in my 20s when I was on a volunteer fire department was we didn't talk about the traumas that we saw. You know, so when I went back to get my social work degree, it started into the space of, well, how can I help men? And how do we talk about all that sort of bad stuff that we have going on? And when I opened my practice, again, there was this anxiety of, am I going to be viewed as a person who is discriminating against, you know, say, women? And I actually worked with Katie Vernoy, the Therapy Reimagined group, which most people might know about. And she said to me, you're doing something great. Own the niche. Let the anxiety go, because men out there need other men to show them a different pathway forward, that we don't have to hold this stuff in, that we can, you know, talk about whatever we have going on. And so through her and her help and her support, we worked on niching down into a space of, yeah, my practice, again, is inclusive. But the reality is there's a lot of men out there that need help. We don't know how to ask for it. So I'm giving them a platform to say, well, there's a guy over there that will help you figure that out. And it's also about breaking down some, you know, systemic issues. I work with men around patriarchal thinking. I work with men around their feelings of race inequality with themselves. I see a lot of Caucasian white men who say, well, what about me? Well, let's talk about that. We can figure those things out. So the niching, you know, again, it was a hard sort of thing to do because I didn't want to be viewed as a person who was discriminating against anybody. But the reality of it is the better work that I can do with men and help them, I think societally we have a shift. And really where that sort of also started was, I've been working on my PhD for what feels like forever. And I started doing research on men's issues, men's health issues. And again, I was seeing like, we're dying. And that terrifies me. And I don't want people in this world to just die because we're not taking care of ourselves. And I want men to be better men so that we can support the world around us. And, you know, so when I think about how do I do that? Well, I help men. And that's where my niche came from.
Yeah. And one kind of theme that I heard there is this worry about when you call certain people in, you repel other people. But at the end of the day, as clinicians, we get to decide who we are best meant to serve. And if that means a person outside of our niche calls us or emails us and we have a conversation with them and it actually seems like they're a good fit, they'll still find us. So even with my niche being super specific, I work mostly with high earning couples who have financial anxiety and money shame. I see people outside of that one specific line when people find me and they go, actually, I'm a little bit up here, I'm a little down here, and we get to decide at the end of the day. So John, let's talk about niching for you. How did you get there and what worries did you have to overcome?
Well, you know, it's interesting because I actually want to address what you just spoke to as well. This idea that if we niche, we lose the abundance and diversity of our practice. And the thing that I find really fascinating is by niching, I'm actually doing my best work with clients. And that's actually built my reputation in the community as being a really good therapist. So I actually do have, I mean, I specialize in LGBTQ adolescents, but I actually work with the LGBT community at all ages. And I also have a background in grief work. I have training in trauma modalities. I'm a yoga teacher and bring mindfulness and pieces like that into all the work I do. So that in the middle of this niche, I still get calls from people who are a beautiful and direct response because they've heard that I'm a good therapist. And so right now, I mean, my youngest client just turned 14, just the other day, yay. My oldest client is 72, and I have people from all different walks of life who work with me. Now, how do I put myself out of the community? As a specialist in LGBTQ issues. For me, this came about, I mean, I'm an openly queer man. I'm open in my practice and therapy and all the work that I do. And when I was doing my internship, I was working at a family services clinic. And in that clinic, I had opportunities to work with young ones, with older people, with couples, with teenagers. And very quickly, and this is nothing that I knew about myself, I found out that teenagers just automatically opened up to me. I remember going into supervision one day and saying, yeah, I was talking to one of my teens about like what their beliefs about God was. And the whole room was like, you had a teenager talking about spirituality? It's like, it just happened. And that kind of opened up my eyes that there was something unique that I had inside myself that teens were responsive to. And I wanted to pursue that. The other thing that happened too, though, in really specializing the LGBTQ work is I also was one day in supervision and someone's working the client and they've been describing some things that have been going on for a while. And I simply pointed out, do you think there's any questions about their sexual orientation? And nobody else in the room had thought about it. And they went back and worked with another client and it turned out that this person was exploring their sexual orientation. And it got me to realize that for most of us in our basic grad school programs, we get very little training on working with the LGBTQ community. There are lots of very well-meaning therapists out there who are trying to offer services, but I think with any specialized community, this is a place where training is really important. And so I took my life experience. I did a lot of training and studying myself because I didn't want everyone to have the same experience I had. And that really helped me to focus on this niche. And this idea too, that's what got me excited about the training piece, is because most of our programs, nobody's talking about my community. And so I wanted to get out into the world. I wanted to help other therapists, other people, corporations, schools, understand how important it is to create affirming environments. And I thought that was really, really vital. But there's one other thing that I want to talk about niche, because I think this is such an interesting thing. So I'm adjunct faculty at Phillips here in Los Angeles, and I actually teach a marketing class for the interns. And whenever you hit this niche thing, everybody freaks out because they're like, oh, I'm limiting. And as you've heard us talk about, we actually found a population that we love to work with, and that's how our niche developed. But I also have another niching philosophy that I help some people work with, and it's the idea that sometimes the niche can actually be you, the therapist. So I'm a yoga teacher. I bring that yoga energy, that meditation energy, and this really weird, goofy sense of humor into my work. I could niche that because not everybody is looking. If you look through most people's descriptions, webs like compassionate, caring, all of those buzzwords that we use. Well, isn't the least common denominator of what we would want a therapist? They would be compassionate, caring, and a good listener. So what about niching all our unique individual qualities of who we are? Hearing about Alli's like entrepreneur background and the energy that carries with that, you know, wanting to sit down with Courtland and hear like how his life story has influenced how he does his work. That to me is niche also. So I think there's another approach we can do when we look at niching that's not always about the client, but that sometimes it's actually about what we bring into the room as well.
Oh, so beautiful. And I think we could go into a whole tangent on that marketing and niching piece, because again, so many of us therapists have been told you have to hide yourself. You can't disclose. I'm a brown woman. So when people ask about my race, I don't go, why did you ask me that? Right? I say, I'm Filipina and white. What do you think is the reason that it's important for you to know that, right? And we have an open, honest conversation. And John, for you to openly identify and say, hey, I'm a queer man and welcome into my practice, that helps, in my opinion, to allow clients to bring their full selves into the room. We cannot hide who we are. And so I love that in niching, we can also tap into ourselves and go, what is unique about me? And how can I help bring that into the work with my clients? So for this question about what would have been helpful for money stories, we'll start with Courtland, then go to John, and then to Alli. So when we think about money stories, in specifically in how it showed up in your private practice, what would have been helpful for you when you were starting to work through them? I know, Courtland, you'd mentioned that having your partner say, hey, you don't have to do that, was a nice reminder. What other things might have been helpful at that point in time for you?
Yeah, you know, I think there's a couple of things that come to mind about what would have been helpful. The first is, I don't think there's a lot of good education out there for sort of just basic money issues. And about, this is probably actually 6 months ago, that has really sort of stuck with me. I read this book, it's called I Will Teach You to Be Rich by Ramit Sethi. And it's very, very basic rules for how to sort of navigate and manage your money. I wish somebody had given that to me when I was like, I don't know, like 23 or something like that, right? I mean, the book didn't exist then, but one of the things he addresses is like, what are your rules for your money? How do you set it and forget it, right? And what he means by that is like, how do you pocket out certain amounts of money to go to certain savings accounts and certain bills? And then, you know, what's your discretionary spending? So that at the end of the day, when you look at your accounts, you can say like, well, it's okay if I want to buy myself that cup of coffee, or I want to buy myself that new pair of shoes, or whatever it is, because you've set up a system for your money. And when I started to build my private practice, you know, I thought I had a good handle on the financials of it. And, you know, I was able to set up some systems, but this book opened my eyes to setting up not only systems for my business, but also for me. And the other book that comes to mind is Profit First. And with Profit First, again, it's sort of the same stuff. It's the idea that you're paying yourself, you're owning your own value, and, you know, offering yourself a wage, because we have to get paid for the work that we do. And I've sort of built my own system out of those two books, but the stories that came from those books that, you know, these two people tell really influenced how I start to think about stuff. And again, you know, I wish somebody had sort of said, you should take a look at this stuff. You know, we can go back to the money stories that we're all talking about, right? In my family, money was a way to survive as opposed to what I consider a tool, right? So now I'm using my money as a tool. I know that I would like to make X amount of dollars. So how do I reverse that, right? And when I think about how people think about money, right? You mentioned before, you know, there's a little bit of guilt, right? That I might have about maybe earning more. I had to work through some of that stuff, and I don't feel guilty anymore. It might pick up here and there, but I think that learning how to navigate the story, and then also learning how to use money as a tool, right? How to sort of think about how we break that tool down. You know, what's the use of that tool? And I just think that stuff wasn't quite there when I was growing up, and now having some of that in place feels like I'm in control of my money. And, you know, for my private practice, you know, one of the things that I also think about was, how do you build a business that's solid so that when hard times hit, like we're all in right now, and you see a dip in income, can your business sustain? You know, and that started from the beginning. When I built my private practice, for example, I automatically started to put away tax money. I started to put away a savings account for that business, because that business is a living, breathing thing. and it has to be fed and sustained. And, you know, when the pandemic started and I lost a month and a half's worth of income, the business was still alive, you know, and I didn't panic. You know, we talk about how do we manage the money stories? Well, we learn not to panic, right? We learn to pocket things away, if you will, in different accounts. And we learn to have our money grow, right? Which is things that I just didn't understand until I'm almost, I'll be 40 at the end of this week. But I didn't know that stuff, you know, when I was in my 20s. And I wish there was some better things that had existed. You know, I think they existed. They just weren't put in front of me, right? And my hope for people is that they can sort of find these tools and then build upon that stuff for themselves.
Awesome. So some practical tools would have also been really helpful. Happy early birthday. And John, what about you?
You know, it's interesting. I think I learned my tool-based stuff before I did this career. The thing that I think would have helped me the most actually is a philosophical stance. And it has to do with the idea that we as therapists are told not to talk to each other about money. There's even a very popular rumor that somehow it's an antitrust thing for therapists on a Facebook group to talk about what their fees are. Well, people, that's actually not true. The thing is we as a profession have become so secretive ourselves about money that I, as a new therapist, couldn't talk to anybody and learn about their financial journey. Like what we're doing today wasn't going on, and it doesn't happen in a lot of conversations with therapists. I think it's a rare group that we have right now that is so openly talking about their financial story. Because the other thing that we've done too is that we have trained our clients to approach us in a certain way. And it's the thing about sliding scale. And I want to just talk that a little bit because I personally, my practice, do not have a sliding scale. I'm an all cash practice and I never have had a sliding scale. What I do help with someone who can't afford my fee is I have a great referral list of agencies, lower cost therapists, interns in the area that person could go to. But if you think about it, we have trained our clients to ask for sliding scale. You don't call up your dentist and make an appointment for a teeth cleaning and say, oh, and do you have a sliding scale? You don't call your doctor and say, you know, I need a checkup. Do you have a sliding scale? We, as a profession, have created this story of sliding scale. And I think we need to be able to talk more about that. Why is it that we feel that we have to slide, that we have to put our needs behind someone else's needs in a moment when we can find them the needs with other practitioners in the community? I want to make clear that that's always available. And so for me, I think if we philosophically as therapists could learn to start talking more openly about money and money stories and why we charge and help each other to raise fees and say, hey, I hear you're afraid of raising your fees. I support your move 100%, but to talk about it openly and not make it a fear-based story in our profession.
Ugh. Couldn't agree more. So much wisdom shared there. And yeah, so for all my listeners, I also don't do a sliding scale. So Alli, what about you? Tell us a little bit about what would have been helpful when you were first starting the money story work in private practice.
Yeah, absolutely. I think kind of like John, I think I was very, very privileged in the family that I came from the sense of the tools and a lot of resources being there and not just being there, but modeled to me, which is a gift I recognize not many people probably have. But I think applying it to my role as a therapist and being able to be both entrepreneur and therapist, which when you think about them, those roles, the entrepreneur is more of a masculine energy driven role and the therapist or the coach is more of a feminine energy-driven role, and trying to marry the two was definitely something that I struggled with in the beginning. I think actually having a coach talk about how we all have both those energies, both masculine and feminine energy, and how valuing both is very important in many entrepreneurial fields, which is kind of my mindset because of my family background, that masculine energy go, 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 do more, achieve was very strong. And it really felt like it had to be one or the other. And learning how to be that therapist who is okay with stating kind of what John was saying, this is my rate, and being okay with that and sitting with that discomfort, right? Tolerating the distress it causes for ourselves in that moment and knowing that we can still be maintaining that therapist identity while also charging what we're worth, and then refer out because there are other people in other places. The specific tool I think would have been most helpful would maybe have just been having a couple of the webinars and books that I've been reading a little bit sooner. I think I started that process about a month into private practice because of the entrepreneurial background. It was naturally a place that I went to, but maybe a month earlier still would have been better because I did start with sliding scale fee in the beginning because of that thirst, right? You're a new therapist and you just really want to get clients in the door. But recognizing how that will, if you kind of like playing that movie in your mind and visualizing, if I play this movie out and this client stays with me for 6 months, 2 years, you know, maybe it's a lifeline client. How am I going to navigate that? What's that going to look like? And I think if I had slowed down a bit and been more in that being energy instead of just going, I might have thought that through a little bit better and also not felt pressure to go that sliding scale route in the beginning. It's interesting because therapists, we have all of these skills and so much knowledge, and yet so many times we play out what I talk to my clients about a lot, which is the Cartman's drama triangle. And we have these three roles and dramatic relationships that we fall into with the rescuer and the victim and the persecutor. And so often therapists fall into that rescuer role. Like if I'm not the one who helps them at that fee, no one will be able to help them or they won't get any resource. And by doing that, we could actually be causing some harm to the client because we're bringing that energy and that role already from the get-go into that therapeutic relationship. It's been challenging at times when clients hit hard times and navigating and balancing, you know, do we make exceptions or adjustments? I think every therapist has to listen into their intuition about what that looks like for them in their practice. But I think one of the biggest things that's been helpful to me as more time has gone in is learning to slow down, really check in with myself and what feels right and what feels like it's in alignment with my values and my business model, and playing that movie out to see, do I, out of my own anxiety in this moment, say yes, right, to a sliding scale fee or to making an adjustment that maybe I don't really want to make? And how is that going to both serve my business well and the client? Because we only can serve as well as we are feeling. And if we are feeling resentful or feeling overwhelmed and burned out, not only will that then affect that one client, but it also affects the rest of your caseload as well. So I think learning to make decisions that are best for everyone in the long run, but also what John was saying is like we as individual people matter and we don't need to make ourselves be martyrs or victims. I think that was a hard mindset shift coming out of community mental health.
Yeah, thank you for sharing that. And I hear a lot of somatic work in your tools of like checking in with your body, checking in with what feels good as another way to work through those money stories. So lightning round before everyone goes to see their next client. This is hard for therapists because I'm going to make you pick one thing. What is your favorite thing about being in private practice? And John, we'll start with you.
Seeing that beautiful moment when a client has a breakthrough that you've all been working for a while and it happens and you both sit there in that stunned silence and your eyes look at each other and you go to that deeper place than the reality you're in and you both know that something changed.
Oh, that moment of change. Allie.
I think for me, it's freedom for myself and getting to share that freedom and help other people achieve that in their lives.
Hmm. Yay, freedom. And Courtland.
My favorite thing is that the private practice is alive. It makes me feel alive. And when I'm in that space with another person, you know, it's two people sharing their lives in aliveness and robustness. And we're just sharing stories. And that is a real, the words don't sort of convey it, right? It's a gift that somebody comes in and tells you things they never tell anybody else. And again, you're just sharing that, two people being alive together.
Oh, well, you guys, this was so special. Thank you so much for taking the time to share with me and each other and the listeners all this stuff about money stories and what we pick up, and for really embodying that you can be, in fact, a good therapist and make good money and be ethical and all of those worries that so many of us therapists have. for my listeners, everybody's who was on today, their websites will be linked in the show notes and you'll be able to get in touch with them there. Thank you all again. Have a lovely rest of your day and we will talk soon. Did you love listening to this episode as much as I loved interviewing everybody and recording it? I thought it was so helpful to hear from different people about how they worked through their money stories. And I also thought it was so helpful to have them shed light on what would have been helpful for them when they first started out on their money mindset work. So some of them said they needed a tool. Some of them said they needed like accountability or mentorship. And to that end, I'm thrilled to let you know that I am about to kick off an 8-week group coaching program called Build a Profitable Practice from the Inside Out. My friend Monica from Hold Space Creative and I have teamed up to help clinicians who've been in private practice for over a year. We will help you raise your prices in accordance with the value you deliver for your clients so you can stop seeing a million clients a week and call in the exact right clients you are called to serve, so you can end your day without feeling drained and overwhelmed and stressed out about paying the bills. So if you are listening and you're ready to increase your income in a way that feels aligned with you, with your unique income needs, then please check out all the details at my website. It's mindmoneybalance.com/profitable practice, all one word, mindmoneybalance.com/profitable practice. The group will start on September 14th, so we need all applications in by September 2nd, 2020. So if this sounds good to you and you want to learn more, make sure to check that out just as soon as possible.
Neither the host or guests are rendering legal, accounting, clinical, medical, or other professional information. If you want professional help, please seek it out.